So thank you very much for coming to our speech about the topic is named Back to the Roots, like something that we are going back from the high flight. Like if you have watched the video at the LinkedIn or Facebook, I was almost scared. Talking about how our the Tieto journey has come so far and how we are going back to the deep dive in the in our process, in our organization, our people, right? So let's get started. To introduce ourselves, I'm Edgars. I am a Scrum Master in Tieto, as well as I'm a coach, and I do some coaching stuff outside the work. I'm a sports athlete, psychology coach.
Tell them that you're a Karate Master.
Oh, no, no, okay? They don't need that.
People need to be prepared.
They don't need to know that.
Okay, so, that's me. You look like me. I'm consider myself evergreen, agileist, whatever that means. I'm kind of stay fresh all the time, trying to, at least. So there's a storyteller, so there will be a story, and Edgar will kind of do a retrospect of what actually happened in Tieto and how we come to the present state, what we have right now.
All right. So. For those who actually don't know, the Tieto is a big company. It's a big, really big company with different types of businesses inside. And we are really talking about the IRPC unit, which stands for the retail payment and cards, instant retail payment and cards. A company with millions of euros of revenue with 300 people, which work there full time. Well, building a banking platform for cards and account payments, and we started an agile.
Well, you forgot to say that you're selling. You already got a product that you are selling.
Of course,
you're making money. You're successful. Okay, so why? Why you started agile? Do you have like some kinds of...
Okay, this is really have to do something with starting agile. Why?
You got a portfolio. You got everything.
Right. That's right. This is starting agile. It's like we had a plan. We had a plan of delivering the product that really market demands, that someone really needs, and we wanted to make a bit more satisfied employees. It was something like we started with. This was our goals, and we wanted to go faster in the market. So. It's you know, every start, every goal is clear, and it's you know, like
so you set up the way and you see the goal that you're trying to achieve,
right? I mean, no one sets up the bad goals, right? Everyone
wants
to set up
the
good goals.
To be better.
And the first year, actually, well, the question is, who's the old guy? Who's the old man?
I guess that's you when you started the job.
Oh man,
isn't it? It looked like you.
Oh, it looked no. Actually, the question: who's the old man? Anyone? The one. Just pick the one. Socrates. All right. So then, for those who answered the right question, I have the Snickers. Right. In the introduction, we said the last word, the Snickers. So one Snickers for you. Nice one. And the Socrates
people
said...
People has to be rewarded.
Yeah, of course. So then, what did the Socrates said? He said that if you want to implement any change, you shouldn't be fighting with the old stuff, and you should plan and build the new stuff. So that's what we actually did. We made a plan, we made an educational stuff. People of the upper management went to the trainings, and they trained us.
In agile juices.
Yeah, they understand that, and they wanted to know the stuff. Okay, and then they trained us, and then we trained the bottom layer for the juice developers and testers. And we were doing actually some process of the agile. Well, 3 years. It was 2013. It wasn't really agile, it was some process of Scrum, it was project manager. At that time I was a project manager. So some stuff was actually logical, purely logical, and we understood that. But the governance wasn't so agile and Scrumish. So from the from the burst view, the picture of the Scrum, you know, like the product backlog and the sprint backlog and the Scrum cycle, like that one of the year, and everything looked actually fine. It was pretty logical, promising, right? It was. You couldn't argue with that. Okay, we just come and build the right thing in the right time, and then the Scrum Master role. Okay, and could you just imagine if you ask someone, like for your friend, and what you do for a living? And he said, "Well, you know, I do actively nothing." That's what all coaches says, right? You just do actively nothing. So what does that mean?
So you bought the idea of doing nothing
right.
for a change.
Right. What didn't do nothing actually. We started to do something and nothing right. at the same time.
Okay. Already we had like that a great plan.
Experience, right? You know. Okay. Afterwards, the second year came up, and with our experience in some project management stuff, in some Scrum process stuff. We had a lot of misinterpretations, misunderstandings of what Scrum really is. What is Scrum? What are we doing, actually? And what is the daily Scrums and what is the retrospect? Oh, we should do this and then we do that. And
so the first implementation and learning curve wasn't enough, so you had to
right.
To
we
it.
Didn't have actually the despair part with the previous okay. So, well, aren't you stuck? So actually, we defined in the plan actually the daily scenarios, like what do we do when the customer asks us to build the CR, or what do we do when the support type of person creates a bug, and what do we do? That is actually described in daily scenarios. But we had the puzzles, which were actually disconnected. They were. So imagine a puzzle that's not connected. It's just puzzle.
So you didn't yeah. get the picture. Anything.
Yeah, the picture is so like so something really. Yeah. There's something really is missing there.
All right, yeah? Gotcha idea.
The idea, and at the 17th year, we had the half, like it was half an, a year and a half, and we actually you can find in the 17th year the romance was telling the learnings from the transformation journey. So you can deep dive there to find out that point. What was holding us down. So I'm moving from that side and continuing to the year 2018, we started to asking questions to ourselves. What's the problem actually? What are we doing? We had a big picture of the Scrum.
Of small pieces.
Of small pieces, like copying that inside an organization. We actually understood that we came up in the infinite loop. Like doing stuff, doing, and nothing
and not
changes. Nothing
anywhere.
Really changes. Nothing changes. Something's wrong. We're starting asking ourselves questions. Why is that there? Why is it? I am trying to do something, but actually, nothing actually changes. And just for instance, do you understand that we don't have actually projects? We have one product that we build and we sell them to customers, the different type of customers. We don't have projects that we can build up new teams and the project setups, or we can experiment so easily with that. So every experimentation should be really, really easy going, planned, so we just don't make too much damage to the organization. So we as well are
business.
Really afraid of that, so we don't scare people. Well, and at that time, Vladimir Skamin, we wanted to see the view from the different perspective. Every Scrum Master in the organization was actually from the inside. Either that was a technical person, either that was a manager actually, splitting the roles, being line manager and the same Scrum Master. So we
classical
opened the position.
Scrum Master, project manager.
All right, yes. And we opened the position. We wanted to have a Scrum Master from outside. And luckily we found the Vladimir's. So at that time, Vladimir came in. Seeing the whole
not my
picture.
That's like, yeah, okay. Yeah, like, so I came kinda this way, and there was a certain question in the air. Certain question was, where do we go now? Well, actually, we just looping on the same place. But for me, that wasn't a question because I was going to Tete and I was excited. Like, I'm joining. Doesn't matter. I'm joining the big organization that implemented not only less, but huge less. It's like huge less, my God. And I was trained specifically for that. I just got the right knowledge, the right things, and I'm like, thank you. I will try to be very gentle with that. Like, I was excited. Yeah. No. Doesn't matter.
I'll fix that.
Okay, so my first impressions was based on my own expectations, basically. So if there was some kind of some sort of hope that I will provide clear vision of what I see in an organization, so they just bet on the wrong person at the wrong time, because my expectation was so high. It was inflated, basically. It was inflated by the anticipation. It was okay, but you keep on moving.
Oh.
Stop.
So
sometimes okay. It's time to stop. Okay. So it was inflated on the anticipation of further discovery. So I think, I'm gonna see real areas. I'm gonna see real area product owners.
So now you're gonna see something like so building like, the product,
yeah,
right?
What I was really expecting. And but from that height of expectation, when I met the reality, I just plummeted from like, that's not real, I'm joining, to like, that's not real. That's actually not real. Because that's what all the other speakers were talking about. The same old problems, but in own specific way. So I was going through the teams, the way of work, the what people actually do. I was meeting with the managers. We had an internal presentation, internal kind of events with speeches. And management actually had the vision of agility, kind of that sharing my vision, and they were promoting me with message, like, yes, go and send this message so that we shouldn't be like doing bad things to the.
So they just give you a green light, okay, yes, let's go, so let's do this.
I didn't say any problem with the management. So management was open. Okay, so I went to the teams. Yeah, there was some kind of a silo. So to give you an understanding, so that, for example, my first team was a kind of guys with a senior. Not in terms of like senior developer, junior developer, they were senior. Actually, since I started, two people went on retirement. So you would expect not some like cutting edge type of attitude and technologies floating in this team, but no. Well, like it wasn't, of course, kind of avant-garde of development, but these people were kind of lively. And they still are, and they're really open for any kind of challenges that come in their way. They're attacking the problems. They're planning the future, not in the way how the just was kind of set up. We got a deadline. We need to deliver. No.
So they were
It was kind of in a transitional way. So from the kind of classical project management to what is agile expected. So there's no problem with the team. There's no problem with the manager. But there's a constant kind of moaning between so there's a constant feeling of a problem. And really, there's no one in the management this one. No one in the team this one. Almost like everything perfect. But the feel and sense of the something is rotten, something is off, present. So basically, I try to rethink in my head to understand what's going on. What why I get in this feeling? What is actually off here?
So actually something's really missing again.
Yes, right. So something missing, and that's the moment I'm really proud of myself. Can brag. So I thought that maybe it's not something missing in the system. Well, there's certainly miscommunication. There's certainly detached areas. Some people are not talking when they should, but that's again a complex organization, so that's normal, and you have some kind of a lack of communication. But the maybe the missing piece is my understanding of the system. There is a system. It's working. It kind of fits the description, but it gives you a gut feeling that's not the right way. But the rest, the numbers, everything, fine.
Okay.
So what actually answers my question, it's what this guy, by the way, do you know him? It's not Socrates. Well, you can read, yes, I guess. But anyone can get a sneakers for who can say who is Michael Fowler. Martin Fowler is.
Fowler, right.
Yes. Well, it's related to the event.
He's somebody knows him? Put your hands. Oh, one, two, okay, three. Nice, three person, okay.
Yay. No. Get your sneakers from Edgar later. Okay, so yeah, one of the Agile Manifesto creator said in the last year that actually our first problem is dealing with Agile industry complex, which is imposing methods on people. And that the aha moment which led me to this was that, again, what was mentioned in the previous presentation, that say Agile one more time. That's that thing. When I was talking to the people, they are open to a certain extent. They are fine. But whenever I use some kind of Agile terminology, whenever I talking as a Scrum Master, about retrospective, about stand-up, about anything, I saw an immediate reaction as a either aggression.
Okay, stop this one. Just stop this one, right?
Or just retreat and get quiet. Okay. That was immediate. And here I need to take a side note. I switched the slides because that why question, previous one, was really not the previous one. No, whatever. It was still begging me why this happening. Yesterday I've actually finished the courses of Anna Obuchova, which finally answered this question to me. So I recommend, highly recommend for you, to if you are interested in why kind of guys talking about the same thing, sometimes not just hearing each other. Well, so certainly the change should come. The change should be here, but is this a change of the things that we're working with, like team, people, management, organization itself, or the change required in some other level? And as this guy, again, who knows who's this guy is?
Oh, there's a only one, a second one. Okay.
Right. Tell others. So as he pointed out, it's maybe hard to make a simple change. And change should be simple. Exactly. So we already in the hard part of the transition, so probably we go in the same the right way, but what is the key thing we're actually trying to change? What is needed to be changed if the problems are not detected in the whole areas that we inspected?
That's right.
So basically,
so the mechanism, the what?
What is the problem?
What are the problems? So does what who's the guy? The guy, this frictional guy.
Yes,
Celeste.
And you get all the last snicker.
Yes, the last snicker goes to you, right?
Finally.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. And the guy is actually frictional, but the quote is actually pretty live, right? Why are we trying to find the problems where they shouldn't have been? Is it our conscious mind that we are trying to ask people to work the way we actually want? Isn't that, can you raise your hands that someone tries to ask people to
at
work in the
feel the urge to tell the people how they
like
must
in Scrum
do
we do
something.
This and this and that and why you should do this and the one honest person in this room
I guess.
Okay. Does anyone have implemented the board, the Scrum board or Kanban board in the organization, like putting the okay, 2, 3, 4, 5 okay, only 5. So is the Scrum board mandatory in the Scrum? Some say yes, some say no, some nods like I don't know. Okay.
Nice
good.
To have.
Nice. So it actually isn't. And the problem is actually our attitude, not that actually that there is a problem because they don't visualize stuff. And we actually have experience, and the one of the teams are Vladimir's team, who actually does the sprint completion rate for 85% without the Scrum board. And actually they don't need it. They stand up and they discuss things. They come with the plan.
They even don't stand up sometimes.
And sometimes they even don't stand up.
Well, it's not a good thing. But
then should we ask them to stand up at that case? What should we do that, actually? And
well, actually, the attitude for the problem answers the question, who is imposing?
Right.
What is agile industry complex actually is? Because it's not in the management level. It's not in a kind of a other organization level. It's kind of go through. And it's been mostly imposed, and we have to be ashamed of it. It's mostly imposed by the hands of the Scrum Masters, those who are taking the role of Scrum Masters, those who pushing people to do the things they hate. Just like the thing I asked you to do in the beginning. I saw your faces.
Again, standing up, again.
Yes, exactly that feeling. Exactly that feeling throughout the day, every day, in the morning, once, twice, like a week for planning, for a retro, for whatever. That's exactly the feeling the people experiencing.
The change and the attitude should be easygoing, actually, right? So that we invite you and it's not like, okay, stand up and retrospectives. And no, that should be really easygoing. And
basically what I achieved with one of the teams, that the team is going for some kind of this events. When I just don't call these events this like agilistic names, I then don't use word the retrospective. I just telling that we need to discuss some stuff that happened. Like what stuff? Yeah, there's agenda. Maybe you got something, and it happens. The discussion goes on because people are really interested. They're really interested in solve the problem, but they imposed to do a retrospective. And that's a huge, huge difference for the people who are really going into the transition phase from the classical to the agile way of working.
Okay, so just to move forward.
So another plan,
right?
Another plan, another maybe roller coaster, maybe learning curve, maybe both, maybe just some kind of infinite loop.
Yeah. We're gonna
Nobody
see that.
Knows, but there is another plan laid out. And one thing is excluded from this plan is actually this imposing. So what we're aiming right now to do, and I already started with some of my teams, that it's actually removing these things that I feel hated by people. So they hate the concept of be obligated to something, to do something, in order so the project manager, whoever may check the checkbox, that, yeah, we implemented standards. Nobody really needs this.
Okay.
So, okay, maybe let's see what the
so
points of the plan.
Right, that's right. Actually, why is the war coming? War is between the people, right? It's not, you can't make war with the technique or whatever, like services.
In Terminator,
it's just between the people. So what the one of the plans is actually to grow the culture that can be maintained. And you'll have the slides, by the way. You don't have to picture them. will support the improvement of the ability to change and deliver the product to customers that really customers need, the changes that they need. And you know the quote that guns don't kill people, yeah, right? Who kills people? People kills people, right? The same as goes here. Agile doesn't make product. Agile is only the tool. It's a framework that helps us. Yeah, and people make products. So why do we do war? We need to somehow build the culture that can be improved, that can be sustainable, that can go forward, and it could be beautiful.
Yeah, and right? Basically peace just doesn't exist by itself. If Edgar will switch the slide, I can read this fancy, or maybe not, Sivis Pass from Parabellum. Again, question, who knows this? What does it mean?
Does someone know? Okay.
Yes. Exactly. So basically, in a concept of peaceful existence of a business, peaceful existence of a process, peaceful existence of organization should be armed. It should be powerful to face the unknown, which is the future. Of course, for the organizations like Seattle, maybe there's a future laid down and there's a lot of plans, there's a new customers coming, there's a new contract signed, so it looks pretty much okay.
Pretty fine, but like that's why we need an agile, right?
Because nobody removes the risks, like where will be Huawei in a couple of years?
Who knows? Yeah, right.
So that's the thing that you never think of. So that's the ability to be prepared.
Right.
And what is the weapon, Edgar?
And our weapon is actually our experience, and this is what we don't want actually to fight with the processes, tools, peoples, or something like that. We want to fight with our incompetency of in stuff when building up the technological excellence and the culture, the way to be adaptive, the way to have a plan and to change the plan, and to do that, imagine just a picture about the roads. Vladimir's had a very good explanation of that. Any flower doesn't grow in the environment that's rotten, right? That's right. Yeah. And in order to grow that flower, we actually need to build the environment that is capable to do so.
Well, in other words, yes, you expect to provide the food, the nutrition. So the culture that you expect to be will grow. And it will grow only in specific environment. And it's impossible just to set up each other mind to think in the same way. There should be a learning curve. There should be some kind of alignment with throughout the open conversation, open talks, just a normal human communication. So basically, how we can achieve this, Edgar? How we can achieve to grow up something? And I think basically it's go back to the roots,
right?
Understand where this company is coming from. It's not appearing out of the blue. There was a way to success. So in a expectation of having the fruits keep on this company delivering, you must care about the roots of that.
Right.
So and it's been fed, it's been healthy.
Right, and if we have some puzzle pieces that are not connected, then one of our roots that we should tackle is the connection. Right.
Yeah, and basically, what is also Scrum Master's maybe first thing, it's make sure this adaptation to the new things that come into the company, new people that come into the company, new kind of blows in the wind come into the company, is adapted by the old rules, because once it's harming the heritage, you are disconnected from where you started from. So you basically you will need to start from scratch.
Right.
In this case, it's not a disaster. We're still going, we're still growing. But we just lost ourselves in the picture. Where are we going? And in this case, I think the best way is to step back and see how the things are getting arranged by themselves, in which shape they want it to be, and help them to grow on that. Because it happened already, happened once in the company, just in a bit in different environment. So right now we have some ability to help grow a new one. It will be successful. Will it fail?
It's in the future. We don't know. Right.
But we shouldn't fight what is growing.
Right. The time will tell.
And yeah, basically, these four things are taken from. Huh?
Sneakers are out, right. But?
Where is taken from?
Ah.
Yes.
Manifesto, yes. Right.
It's just that simple. Yeah, and I think that's what already all organizations have at some point. There is a motivation to the individuals. Because if your organization alive is going, those individuals were motivated at some point. Bring them back to that state. Supported needs. Again, if you had a need and you achieved that already, there was a support for a need in the company. If it's lost, restore it. You should get the best, whatever the best for you, from self-organizing.
We have a history,
that's,
right?
That's not something you should steer all the time to get the shape you want. It should be a self-growing. And of course, that should be based on trust. Because when you trust person, when you really trust person, you have that sort of respect and openness, you always can do the thing that in English is called like go extra mile. But basically, sometimes it's just one small step that you will do for a person which you trust and which you respect. And if anyone who lives in your company, is it in a part that's still not yet agile, is it in agile part, but it doesn't matter. If any person that can make one small step that will create
a big step.
Huge leap of
right.
But that will be a huge movement, the whole company.
Right.
And agile goes in small steps. So huge movement and small steps, that's the way to go. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Right. So, we have 5 minutes, right? So, are there any questions? One, two, three? There are no questions. Very good. Okay, then there was two questions, right? So we wanted to evaluate, did our speech give you something that you take back and you wanted to change, maybe, right? That was the question?
That was the question, yes. Sir.
Change the presenters, that was
okay.
Can you... Any takeaways, any sort of... thinking, any sort of applying it to yourself.
Okay, can you at least evaluate fist of five, 1 to 5, put your hands on the count of 3. Was it worth this presentation, our experience? 1, 2, 3, hop, hey, go. Okay.
4.
Okay, 4, 5. 4, 4, 3, 3, 3.
4.
Okay, 5, okay, cool.
You really liked it?
No. So the half didn't actually even put your hands. Oh, why are you here? Oh.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.